Good, then let's start with statistical methods, aka the GLM. And the topic today is yet another preliminary topic, if you want, namely probability spaces and random variables. So after this first discussion of the GLM in the very first lecture, where we basically glossed over a lot of things and introduced a lot of things, we've been looking into some foundational math aspects in set sums and functions. Then we looked at some calculus that we will need later on for evaluating maximum likelihood estimators, for example. And then last time we looked into matrices because that's essentially the language in which the GLM is expressed. And today we will look at the probabilistic aspects of the GLM. So I wrote down the GLM equation here again. So we have some vector y which models data, and the GLM postulates that this is given or corresponding to a design matrix times a beta parameter vector. And what matrices and vectors are, we've now seen. But what we haven't discussed yet is the fact that this other vector epsilon is actually a random vector. So we mentioned that, but we haven't really discussed what random vectors are. And we stated that this is distributed according to a multivariate Gaussian with this expectation parameter and this covariance matrix parameter. We also haven't really discussed multivariate Gaussians yet, which we will of course do in the session on probability distributions. But to be able to do that, we need to establish some foundations on probability theory and random variables. And this is the aim for today. So the focus is on this aspect here, of course, of the GLM. But what we're trying to do today is only to establish the basis to be able to talk about multivariate Gaussian distributions. And yeah, familiarize you again with the foundations of all of statistics and data analysis if uncertainty is taken into account, namely probability theory. So I hope you all studied the script, and you also maybe had a look at the videos for statistics for data science, where we discussed these things in a little more depth. Here I will highlight the most important things. So what I would like to discuss today are first probability spaces as the kind of the starting point of everything else. Maybe in this regard then also independent events. Then definitely we have to talk about random variables and distributions. So what are probability distributions? And based on that, we will then talk about probability density functions. We will leave out everything that is related to cumulative density functions and probability mass functions, because we will, for the GLM, not need this much. So we can safely leave it out. Later on, if one actually goes into hypothesis testing and so on, then one needs it again. But let's see how far we get with the GLM. Anyway, then we will, once we have established this in the univariate case, then we will generalize this to the multivariate case, which will then lead us to multivariate probability density functions. And that's, I think, already it, except for independence. So we then need to talk about independence so that we can establish that the notion of independent errors later on. So that's the plan for today. So it's essentially a subset of what is in the script, but it's focusing on the things that are of most relevance for the GLM as we discuss it in this course. Jo, then I suggest we just get started. Or are there any questions that anyone of you would like to clarify before we get started?
Yeah, I wanted to actually ask a question about this past week's script. But if we wanted to wait until perhaps at the end of the lecture, that makes more sense. Whichever.
You mean about calculus?
No, about matrices.
Matrices, sorry. Yeah, maybe you just ask it now. So is it about a typo or what is it about?
No, it was just about the question where you asked us to explain the concept of a matrix inverse. And I just wanted to get a better sense of what of the information that was included was actually necessary for such an answer.
The most important thing is that the inverse of a matrix is the matrix that, if multiplied with the matrix of which you compute the inverse, yields the identity matrix. So it's the inverse element with respect to matrix multiplication, and if applied to a matrix, yields the neutral element with respect to matrix multiplication. So it's this part. So ideally, you write up the way I explained it in the script.
Perfect. Thank you.
Okay. Good. Anything else? Good. That doesn't seem to be the case. Then let's go and start with probability. So first, probability spaces. So this notion of probability spaces goes back to Kolmogorov in the 1930s, and the focus here is the fundamental focus here is it doesn't want to do this is to use why does it not stay there is to use set theory to capture aspects of random experiments. So probability spaces are always triples, and these triples comprise an elementary outcome set, which is usually called omega. It comprises a sigma algebra, which is often called A or F, and it comprises a probability measure, which is P. So what are these things and why is this of interest? So omega is an elementary outcome set, of elementary outcomes omega. And the example that is often used to introduce all of this is the dice. So in this case, if you model throwing a dice, then you would choose as your elementary outcome set the six pips, that so the six sides that a dice can show, and the elementary outcomes would be the each of these pips. So the thing that you need to appreciate here is that a probability space model is a very general modeling concept, and in its application to some experimental scenarios, of course, the omega, the sigma algebra R, and the probability measure have to be defined. So it's an abstract concept that summarizes, or that allows you to summarize a lot of different scenarios, but if you want to get a real feeling of what these things are, you need to look at examples. And the example that is discussed in the script at some length is the example of a dice, so please have a read of this. I will mention it in passing here, but I will not go over it step by step because we need to cover quite some ground today. So the first thing in this probability space model, I don't know, it doesn't stay here, is the omega, and that describes your elementary outcomes. The second thing that is in there is the sigma algebra, and in at least for me, understanding the sigma algebra thing was the biggest trouble when talking about, or not when talking, when studying probability spaces during my studies. What's the point of that? So first of all, what is a sigma algebra? A sigma algebra is a set of sets which is closed under the formation of complements. So if you have a set A in there, oops, that's a little bit too much. If you have a set A in there, so a sigma algebra is a set of sets. So in this sigma algebra, there are sets, and if A is a set in the sigma algebra, then also the complement of A is in there. It's also closed under countable unions, so if A1, A2, and so on are in the sigma algebra, then if you compute the or evaluate the union of these A's, then also the union is in the sigma algebra. So that's of course a mathematical formal definition of what this is. It doesn't really explain what's the purpose of it. The point is of a sigma algebra that it's a set that contains all events of interest. For example, if you think of the dice, then you might be interested in events like the pips that are shown by the dice are even, so they are 2, 4, 6, or they are odd, so they are 1, 3, and 5, or they are larger than 3, so they are 4, 5, and 6, or or the outcome is 1. So all of these events are subsets of the elementary outcome space omega, because you can express all of these things that you can verbally express, like the outcome is even, for example, you can identify as being a subset of omega, like I said, 2, 4, 6, for example. And the sigma algebra then is a complete set of events in discrete outcome spaces, such as we have here, where the elementary outcomes are just, for example, the integer numbers from 1 to 6. The power set is typical sigma algebra, so the power set, remember that this is the set of all subsets of omega, or of some set, including omega itself and the empty set. It can be shown that a power set is a sigma algebra, so that a power set always contains with a set, it also contains its complement, and it's closed under countable unions. So it's basically the set of all subsets of omega, and basically allows you to have a comprehensive and full model for a given outcome space. So that's the role of the sigma algebra. It's a mathematical formalization of the fact that if you make up or define a probability model, then you want to assign probabilities to all everything that can happen. And everything that can happen refers to all events, and all events are automatically in this sigma algebra. So it's a complete description of everything that can happen. The thing that is less trouble than the sigma algebra is the probability measure. The probability measure is a mapping, so a function that allocates to each set of the sigma algebra, so each event, because the sets in the sigma algebra are also called events, allocates a number between 0 and 1, which is the probability of this event. Still in latte mode here. And has certain features. So that's the probability measure. It has certain features, namely that the measure that assigns to the empty set, which is also part of the power set or the sigma algebra of the outcome set, is zero. The probability of omega is 1. So the probability for the event in terms of a dice that either 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6 occurs is 1. So that something will happen is 1, and that nothing will happen is 0. And it is, and that's maybe the most important thing, it's sigma additive, meaning that if you have a disjoint sequence of sets in the sigma algebra. So disjoint meaning that the intersection of any two sets in there in this sequence of sets or this family of sets is the empty set, then for I not being j, then the probability the probability that is assigned to the union of this, which is of course guaranteed to also be in the event set, corresponds to the sum of the individual probabilities. And this allows you to, based on defining, for example, the probabilities assigned to elementary outcomes, which are also parts of the sigma algebra because they are also subsets of the outcome set, allows you to specify the probability of any event by specifying the probability of elementary outcomes. So for example, in the die example, if you specify the probability for the event that 1 shows up, for 2 shows up, for 3 shows up, for 5 and 6 shows up, if you specify these probabilities, then you can, based on this sigma additivity, evaluate the probability, for example, that the pips or the dice shows an even number. You can evaluate this based on the fact that the elementary outcomes are mutually exclusive, so the intersection between 1 and 3, or 1 and 2, and so on, is always the empty set, and then the sigma additivity allows you to straightforwardly calculate the probability, for example, for an even number, because even numbers correspond to 2, 4, and 6 in terms of pips. They are mutually exclusive events, so the probability for an even number is 1 over 6 plus 1 over 6 plus 1 over 6, so 3 over 6, so 1/2. again, this is the case if you model, if you assume a probability measure that is uniform. Of course, this is not specified in this probability space model at all, that you somehow, for a dice example, need to assume uniform probability measure associated with each elementary outcome. This is not the point of the probability space model. The point is that if you want to set up a probability space model, you need to define a probability measure on the sigma algebra. And this probability measure satisfies these properties. So the the basic. So maybe one thing to emphasize here, because we will always look at a specific probability space, or usually, is that we are mainly interested in the continuous case where our omega are the real numbers, because we want to model continuous data with our GLM brain imaging data, which is usually modeled by the real numbers or even the real n-dimensional vectors. And our sigma algebra is then what is known as the Borel sigma algebra. And if you want to make your life easy, you can think of the Borel sigma algebra as the power set of the real numbers, so the subset of all the set of all subsets of the real numbers. This is not formally correct, so you can study how the Borel sigma algebra is actually created. And that it's not quite as large as the power set of the real numbers. I think that's the case. But for all of what is actually of interest here, it's fine to think of the Borel sigma algebra as the as the power set of the n-dimensional real numbers. Again, this is an abstract model, so this basically says if you want to use probability theory and use the probabilistic calculus in some application, what you have to do is you have to think about what is your elementary outcome space, what is your omega. Then you should think about what is your sigma algebra. This is actually, in a way, already taken care of. If you have a discrete finite elementary outcome set, you can just use the power set. If you have a continuous outcome set, you can use the Borel algebra, so you don't need to think much about this. But what you need to think about if you apply this model is how does your probability measure assign probabilities. And depending on how you assign, how you define this, of course, you will get completely different things. So you can, for example, if you model at dice, you model that with uniform probabilities associated with each elementary outcome, then of course that's completely then if you calculate other probabilities, these will completely be different to the scenario that you assume a biased dice, or if you so if you have a dice that shows a sixth with a higher probability than 1/6. But what the probability space model allows you to do is to or it tells you what you need to define in order to apply probabilistic calculus. So that's the point of that. And an in-depth example is in the script, where the dice example is spelled out to some degree. Questions about the probability space model at this point? That doesn't seem to be the case, and I still can't scroll today somehow. We need to, so one can do lots of things with basic probability spaces. One thing I want to mention here is the definition of conditional probability, because it will lead us to independence. So the conditional probability of an event A given an event B is defined as the probability of the event that A and B happen divided by the probability of B. And what that means is that the conditional probability of A given B is essentially the probability, the joint probability of A and B happening, and is normalized with respect to the probability of B. This is of course also explained a little bit in more detail in the script. Why I'm mentioning this here is, although we don't need much conditional probabilities when we talk about the GLM, specifically from a frequentist perspective where we don't evaluate any posterior probabilities or something like this, is that it in a way nicely relates to the notion of independence, because independence is defined, so that's conditional probability, maybe let's write that next to it. And independence is defined as follows. So two events are independent if the joint probability of A and B is given by the probability of A times the probability of B. So in school you often assumed this, and you called it, how did you call it? That when you draw these trees in school and you have 1/2 times 1/2 and 1/4, there you always assumed independence when, for example, throwing coins or something. This is corresponds to the statement that the joint probability of A and B to happen is given by the product of A of the probability of A times the probability of B. Why did I mention conditional probability before? Because if you assume that the so if you start with this conditional probability, then it's actually we can start here, and you have independence. So if A and B are independent, then their joint probability is given by this product. And then it turns out that the probability of A given B is just the marginal probability of A. So what this shows is that so of course they're not the definition here, but this is if they are independent. And B are independent, then you have the fact that the conditional probability of A given B is just the probability of A, which means that knowing that B happened, that the event B happened, doesn't change the probability of A to happen. So there is no influence in terms of information of the fact that B happened on the probability of A. So whether B happens or not, the probability of A is the same. So if you think in terms of a current example, if, for example, the current lockdown measures don't have any effect on the infection rate of corona, so then B would be a lockdown appeared, whereas with two outcomes, a lockdown appeared, a lockdown didn't appear, or this partial lockdown that we're currently doing. If the probability for people to get infected is the same given that a lockdown happened or didn't happen, as the baseline probability of people getting infected, then the lockdown does not have any effect on the probability to get infected, and we have an independence case. So I think this thing about the product definition of independence, which is like, yeah, okay, why? So if I have two coins, each one has a probability of 1/2 to come up heads, then the probability for both of them to come up heads is 1/4. Yeah, one can simulate this, but why the product? Why not something else? I think the easiest is to intuitively to think in terms of the conditional probabilities that are then not affected. Or that are the same as the marginal probabilities under independence. This is definitely something that is worth mentioning. Yo, questions about this? Okay, so then we need to continue and go. Now I'm allowed to scroll. To random variables. And please forget everything that you learned in undergrad statistics about variables, because there it's never, so in psychology at least, or at least in Germany, it's never clear whether people talk about random variables or not. People call things independent and dependent variables and so on, but they don't really make clear whether they talk about random variables or not. If they did in your course, you're lucky, that's good. I know that at FU, in FU statistics, they usually don't make that distinction clear. So my colleagues somehow don't like to talk about random variables. What is a random variable? A random variable is neither random nor a variable, but it's a mapping. A random variable maps is a function, like we discussed functions in the session on set sums and functions. It's a function that maps elements of an elementary outcome space into some, oh sorry, my random variable here is xi, maps them into another space, which I call gamma. And of course it takes in an elementary outcome and maps it onto xi omega. So that's the definition of a random variable almost. As it's so a random variable is a function xi from the elementary outcome space into some other outcome space that is measurable. So not every function from a elementary outcome space to another space is a random variable, but it needs to be a measurable function. So what does it mean for a function to be measurable? Well, that means that for each for each s in script s, where script s is a sigma algebra on gamma. So we assume that we have gamma, and we also define a sigma algebra on gamma, and this we call calligraphic S. For each of these subsets of in this sigma algebra, the inverse or the pre-image of this set S, which we denote like this, and which corresponds and is defined as the omega in omega, which get mapped to elements, oops. No. These pre-images are in the original Sigma algebra for all S in S. So maybe one thing I should put in here is that we always assume that there is an original probability space, otherwise it wouldn't also make much sense to say that Xi is a mapping from Omega. So we assume that there is a probability space, which I want to write in here, and we define a function on Omega that maps into some other space Gamma, on which we also assume that there is a Sigma algebra, and together actually Gamma and Mathcal S are called a measurable space. Then a random variable is a measurable mapping, and measurable mapping means that the preimages of all S in the Sigma algebra Mathcal S are elements of the original Sigma algebra R here. Why is this of interest? Well, it's of interest because if this is the case, if we can allocate essentially to each S in S, we can allocate this preimage, and this preimage is in the Sigma algebra, then by the definition of the probability space, this set here is allocated a probability. Yeah, because the original probability space allocates probabilities to all elements of the Sigma algebra. This means then that we can, based on the original probability space, we now get a new probability measure, which we call the distribution of the random variable, and which is defined on this. So maybe I should also make this more transparent, that we also assume that we have this measurable space, Gamma Mathcal script. Given, then we can define, based on the fact that Xi is a random variable, we can define a probability measure on this measurable space here by allocating a value to each element of the Sigma algebra S based on the original probability measure. Which corresponds to, and which is defined as, the probability of this preimage. So, which is of course the same as this here. So what this construction allows here is to define the distribution of a random variable in terms of the probability measure on the original outcome space. So the probability measure, the distribution of the random variable Xi, is defined as in terms of the original probability measure by assigning the same probability to the preimages of S the probability distribution of Xi is defined by assigning to each S in the Sigma algebra math calligraphic S the probability under P of the preimage of S under Xi. That's, I think, the best way to say it. The point is, we have a random variable which maps elementary outcomes into some other space, and the probability distribution of this can be evaluated in terms of the original probability measure. There is a picture in the script which is worth looking at. The thing then with random variables, however, is the following. So this is a way to construct the distributions of random variables in terms of the function that the random variable corresponds to and in terms of the underlying probability measure of the probability space. However, there's also a more direct way of specifying probability distributions, and this will be the way that we will do it. Namely, to specify the distribution of random variables by means of probability density functions. And this then corresponds to the case that we assume that the mapping here corresponds to the identity mapping. So this is the mapping that maps elements onto themselves. The point of all of this, which might sound fairly abstract here at this point, is that one has a unifying model for both discrete and discrete and continuous random variables, and can invoke these concepts if they are necessary. So the probability space is always there and can always, in any kind of random variable scenario, be invoked. Most of the time we don't need it, but we can happily work at this level. Namely, we specify the distribution of a random variable by means of a probability density function. If we want to go back to the underlying probability space model, we can assume that our random variable corresponds to the identity function. Then we immediately get the fact that the underlying probability measure is also the corresponds to the same thing as the distribution of the random variable. Yeah, the other way around that one can work with this is that one specifies the probability measure here in terms of a probability density function, a probability mass function, and then uses the identity function to map this into another space and then have the distribution of a random variable. So that's in 45 minutes the basis of modern probability theory. So I appreciate that this is fairly abstract at this point, but I nevertheless wanted to mention it because it allows to formally introduce what a random variable is without and actually discussing random variables like they are discussed in real life, and not saying something like a random variable is something that takes on random values, which was what I said for a long time. But it's helpful, but it's also fairly wrong with respect to modern mathematics. So I suggest for this part of the lecture have a close read of the example, and also have a look at the videos of Statistics for Data Science, where I discuss all of these things in a little bit more detail. However, the more important things that we will need for the GLM are the things that will follow in the second hour, where we discuss the notion of probability density functions and multivariate probability density functions, because this is really how we specify the GLM, because that's where we have our multivariate Gaussian. Okay, are there questions right now? Okay, everyone is a bit shell-shocked. That's fine. Let's take a break now and at 10:30 continue and get a little bit less abstract and more concretely in terms of formalizing probabilistic models in terms of probability density function. Okay, so then the aim for the next hour is to get from this very abstract model of probability spaces and random variables to an abstraction level that is closer to where we actually work with the GLM, because here we are stating that the error random vector is distributed according to a multivariate Gaussian distribution, and the multivariate Gaussian distribution has a probability density function of a specific form, which we will see when we study probability distributions, or it will come up in the session on probability distributions, where we will define the probability density function of the multivariate Gaussian. But if we define a probability density function, we of course should know what a probability density function is. Otherwise, it's a little bit weird if we define that. So the topic then for this hour is to first discuss the notion of probability density functions, and then also say something about independence again with respect to density functions. So there are what is called probability mass functions for discrete random variables, as you can read up in the script, but we will here focus on continuous random variables. So we use the following definition. So we assume that we have a probability space and we also assume and let Xi, Xi be a random variable. And we assume here that it's actually, and this is in a way the most common definition of a random variable, is that it maps elementary outcomes to real numbers. So some people call random variable call measurable functions only random variables if they actually map to the real numbers. And I should give it differently here. Let this be a probability space, a random variable of this form. So a measurable mapping is called a continuous random variable if it has a PDF, which more formally then is called a continuous random variable. The probability density function, should follow my script here, of a continuous random variable is defined as a function P Xi from the real numbers, so the outcome space of the random variable, so this R here, to the non-negative real numbers . So we are back at how we write functions, obviously. So it's a function that allocates to each value in the real numbers a value pxx. And this function is supposed to have certain attributes kein Blocksatz. With the properties. First of all, it needs to be normalized, so it needs to integrate over the entire real line to 1. Let's do it like this. So the integral, when formed over the entire real line, is 1. And the probability for the random variable xi to take on values, that's actually a typo in the script, to take on values between any two x1, x2, where x2 is larger than x1. Is given by the integral with lower boundary x1 and upper boundary x2 of the PDF. For all x1, x2 in R and x1 smaller or equal to x2. So what does that mean? Well, that means that the probability for a continuous random variable to take on values in a given interval is given by the integral of its density function. So maybe let's do a little drawing here. So if we have a random variable with real outcome space, so we have the real numbers here on the x-axis, and we have some density function. So let's assume that this is some kind of density function, which I now made up, which looks horrible. Let's do this again. Oh, well. Let's do something like this here. That looks better. Then if we want to talk about the probability for a random variable to take on a value in some interval here, so for example this interval, then we should evaluate, or we need to evaluate, the integral of the density function over that interval. So of course, as we learned in calculus, the integral, of course, corresponds to the area under the curve here. So this thing, it looks horrible, but I think you know what I mean. So nice. So this area under the curve here, this integral from x1 to on the interval x1 to x2 corresponds to the probability of xi taking on a value in this interval. If you then think about what is the probability for the random variable xi to take on a specific value, then of course this is the interval, is the integral from x1 to x1 which, if you think about the fundamental theorem of calculus, is of course zero. So the probability for a continuous random variable to take on any real number is zero, and positive probability mass is only allocated to intervals. This all can be made quite intuitive if you think really about what density means in terms of physics. So I hope you remember some high school physics where you learned about the density of certain materials, and the density is just the mass that a certain material has for a unit volume. And then if you don't have a unit volume but a larger or smaller volume, and then you computed mass as density times volume. This is exactly the same thing here. So as volume, you can view the interval length. So if you have a larger interval here, then of course more probability mass is associated with that, assuming that of course the probability density is roughly constant over this interval. The density is here of course the probability density. And the mass that you computed for in high school physics is here the probability mass. So the point is that for continuous random variables, you don't specify probabilities, or you don't specify their distribution directly in terms of probabilities. That's something that you do with probability mass functions, like in cases of Bernoulli distributions, binomial distributions, and so on. But if you're dealing with continuous random variables that take on values in the real numbers, what you specify is a density function, and you can get from the density to the probability by integrating over an interval that you are interested in and for which you want to evaluate the probability that x takes a value in that. Having said that, of course, the intuition is if you have an interval, if you sample from such a random variable, then of course in locations where you have low density, you will also have low probability for intervals lying in this area, meaning that realizations will be rather scarce, whereas if you have intervals where you have high density, meaning that you also have high probability, you will see more observations. Yeah. So if you, for example, plot a Gaussian probability density and samples from this Gaussian probability density, of course you will get more samples where you have high density, because the intervals that are in the area where you have high density, you also have higher associated probability with them. Yeah, but still, one needs to be a little bit careful. If you look at probability density functions, you might sometimes see probability density functions taking on values larger than one. And if you interpret probability density functions as probabilities, then you're of course confused, because probabilities can only be between 0 and 1. But if you interpret them correctly as densities, then you need to always keep in mind that to get to the probability that a random variable takes on values in a specific interval, you need to integrate the density function. So essentially multiply it by the interval length, so the volume that you are interested in. Yeah. Good. So that's the notion of probability density functions. We need to generalize this to a certain degree, because we will deal sometimes with univariate random variables. So our epsilon e here, so each error term is a univariate random variable, but our epsilons together form a random vector, and as we will see later, our data also form a random vector. So we should introduce the notion of a random vector. That's fairly straightforward if you are happy with the definition of a random variable. So let's now introduce the notion of a random vector. So essentially a random vector is just a concatenation of many random variables. So you can either think of a random vector as follows. Let's say an n-dimensional random vector. It's a column vector where x1, 2, xn are random variables. So that's one approach to introduce random vectors. One can also equivalently introduce this more formally. So again, if we assume some probability space omega, and a multivariate measurable space gamma n script s n. So this n is just supposed to mean that it's multi-dimensional. It doesn't need to be that all the different individual subspaces are of the same nature. Then a function, again like a random variable, a function from omega to has all sorts of bugs, this one node thing. If I do a certain combination here, I jump back to the WebEx menu. It's a function from omega to gamma n and allocates to each omega xi omega. And needs to be measurable. And measurable is again defined as we saw above. So there are two ways to think about random vectors either. And the, of course, the most straightforward way to think about random vectors is to think they're just concatenations of random variables. And if you have n random variables and you concatenate them to a vector, then then you have a random vector. Or you start again in terms of probability spaces and measurable spaces, and where the measurable space is a multidimensional space, and then a random vector is a measurable mapping from an elementary outcome space to this n-dimensional outcome space of the random vector. And then multivariate probability distributions are defined in complete analogy, so you can have a read of this in the script. You can of course then also do this for multivariate probability mass function. The important thing that we will need to deal with are multivariate probability density functions, because this is what the Gaussian is. So when we introduce the multivariate Gaussian, we will introduce a multivariate probability density function. So they are then of course defined in complete analogy to this with the appropriate generalizations. So let's make this maybe explicit by just adapting what we've learned for probability density functions. So so we have a probability space. Now we have a random vector, And we consider a continuous random vector, so we map into n-dimensional probability space. This we can get rid of. It's called a continuous random vector. The probability density function of a continuous random, this is a typo actually, vector is defined as a function from the n-dimensional real space to the non-negative real numbers. Again, now these x's here, these small x's are vectors, yeah, so don't forget this. So here x are n-dimensional column vectors comprising real numbers. And the properties are the same. So, oops, I didn't write this down. So this is of course 1. I think I said it, but I didn't write it down. So this integral is 1. And here the integral is formed over the entire n-dimensional space. So there are different ways to write this. One way also to write this is as follows. So one way, so this is vector notation. We can also write this in not vector notation. Then we would have something like this, and we see a little bit more clearer that we have a multidimensional integral here, and the integral we can write like int. So over the entire n-dimensional real space, this probability density function integrates to 1. And the probability for the random vector x to take on a value in a rectangle between x1 and x2, where this smaller or equal than applies to each of the components of xc, so this is how you should read that, that's given by integrating over each of these components. So for x1 we of course for x1 and x2 we have of course a first component which we subscript here, and then we do this for all n components, so up to xn, x1n, and we integrate this over x1 up to dxn. So we of course here have a multiple integral which we need to evaluate. But that's the only difference in terms of multivariate and univariate probability density functions. This, if we choose, if we consider this statement here in vector notation, this still holds true. So the probability for a random vector to take on a specific value or a single value in the n-dimensional real numbers is still 0. If we have a random vector, then we can talk about marginal distributions, and marginal distributions are the distributions of the individual components of a random vector. And to highlight this, we can think of a random vector, an n-dimensional random vector. So let let see be a random vector with PDF P. PXC, oops, small p, PXC. Then the distributions of XI for I from 1 to N are called the marginal distributions. Of XI, and the PDF of a given marginal distribution can be evaluated by integrating over all other components. So by integrating out everything except for the component that we are interested in. So for example, PXI. The PDF, so the marginal PDF in terms of PDFs, the marginal PDF of XI is given by integrating over integrating over X1 and everything else up to X I minus 1, and basically skipping in the integration X I, because we go to X I plus 1 and then doing the rest of the integrations up to xn. Of our multivariate real value probability density function here, and of course we need to also put those here. So this is how we can evaluate the marginal PDFs corresponding to the marginal distributions of XI by summing and integrating out the summing over or integrating out the remaining components. If you want a little bit more of an intuition to that, please have a look at the formation of marginal PMFs. So in the, I think in the discrete case, this is a little bit more intuitive, and you can, this is all spelled out explicitly in the script. The last thing that I want to emphasize here is that the notion of independence translates to two PDFs. So we here introduce independence for events, and in terms of events and elementary probabilities, independence of two events means that the probability for the event A and the event B to occur factorizes in the into the probability of the event A times the probability of the event B. And this can be generalized or translated to the case of random variables. And the usual case to start this is with a bivariate distribution. So let proxy. Be a bivariate random vector. So Xi has this form. So it's a two-dimensional vector with or continuous bivariate continuous random vector with PDF PX then if the which we can also maybe to make it a little bit more explicit, write like this. If the PDF factorizes, then if PX equals the marginal, this is why I introduced the marginal of Xi1 times the marginal PDF of Xi2 for all Xi1, Xi2 in RR2. Xi1 and Xi2 are set to be independent. And so the point here is that if the PDF of a random vector factorizes, so if the oops, there's a typo, if the value that the PDF of Xi1 and Xi2 allocates to each X1 and X2 is the same as the product of the marginal PDFs, then Xi1 and Xi2 are said to be independent. Other way around, if you want to model independent random variables, you can just form their joint distribution by multiplying the individual marginal distributions or the individual marginal PDFs. And this is the case that is happening in the GLM, namely, and this is what we will look at in the Gaussian in a little bit more detail. Here, what we will or what we assume is that the error variables for each data point, they are all independent. So each one has a univariate Gaussian with a zero mean and variance parameter sigma square. Then the joint distribution of all of them corresponds to the product of the individual PDFs, and the product of the individual PDFs corresponds to this multivariate Gaussian with this covariance matrix, as we will see later. But for now, we only introduced the notion of independent continuous random variables. And again, it follows. It's a straightforward generalization from the case of elementary outcomes in probability space models. So this can be generalized from the two-dimensional case to the n-dimensional case. So we can essentially straightforwardly generalize this to the n-dimensional case. We just have a continuous random vector with a PDF PX. There's still the typo. Then if PX factorizes into PX1, so which are again all the individual marginals, to PCN for all real vectors. Then xi1 to xn, are said to be independent. And all of this can, and this is what you can read up in the script again, all of this can be made maybe a little bit more intuitive by considering the conditional PDFs and the conditional PDFs and the marginal PDFs like we did here. So again, this notion in terms of talking about probabilities extends or can be generalized to talking about PDFs, and we can also specify conditional PDFs. And in the case of independence, the conditional PDF of let's say x1 given x2 corresponds to the marginal PDF of x1 under independence. What we will need this for, and what this comes down to in maybe a little bit more applied scenarios, is the fact that if independence is assumed, what then always follows is that the joint PDF factorizes. So this is where you see this kind of fundamental property then in typical, I don't know, machine learning applications, but also a lot of in statistic applications, because often you assume there is some independence. We will see that we assume that the error terms in the GLM are assumed to be independent, which then corresponds to the fact that the joint PDF factorizes into the multiples of the marginal PDFs. Good. So I think this is what I wanted to do today. You see that there's more in the script. Why is all of this important or interesting? Well, it is per se maybe not the thing that you were expecting in kind of data analysis, and maybe not even in statistics, because these are more issues in terms of probability theory. But like the other things that we discussed in terms of sums, sets, calculus, and so on, we will, when we talk about the GLM, we need all of these concepts. So we need to know what a PDF is, we need to know how independence is modeled, we need to know what a random vector is, and the point is that if we then write out the GLM in, for example, multivariate Gaussian form over random variables and study how the estimators are distributed, we will always say, okay, this has a multivariate Gaussian distribution. For multivariate Gaussian distribution, you then we'll encounter, and we will discuss, the probability density function. And if I say, okay, we assume here a multivariate Gaussian and this has this density function, and you don't know what a density function is, then it does not really explain what we are doing. So again, in this session, we basically form a basis for a reference basis for concepts that are completely essential and completely crucial later on, because these are concepts that are not taught in undergraduate statistics to a degree that one actually can build on. So personally, I'm not that keen on teaching calculus and matrices and probability space and probability density functions, because I'm of course working with these entities and building models on them. But if I then are supposed to explain to you what the GLM is, and nobody has heard about what a PDF is, or nobody has heard about how to multiply two matrices, then nothing works. So we have to establish this firm foundation, which, if I were to design undergrad statistics courses, they would of course show up in undergrad statistics courses, and they will in Magdeburg, where I will continue my work starting from April. So there we will have proper undergrad teaching where people actually learn something, and then we can of course focus a little bit more on probabilistic models already at the master level. But from all I know from undergrad statistics in at Freie Universität in Germany in general, but also internationally, the probabilistic and mathematical foundations of statistics are never there. So this is why I'm establishing them here, and you should also familiarize yourself with them, especially as you aspire to become a scientist, and you should go to the foundations of things and not just talk at some high level, put things into a toolbox and then talk about that you use artificial intelligence to understand the brain. You should really know your foundations.